Can you be good without God? It's a question that frustrates some and confuses others, but in this video, we're going to see if we can get to the very bottom of morality. I'm Pat Flynn, and welcome back to Philosophy for the People. So in my first ethics class, my professor was a strong moral relativist, and she believed that morality is really just an illusion. It is a spin-off of the socio-biological evolutionary process, merely a device that helps with the propagation of DNA. So such things as murder or theft or rape aren't really wrong so much as they are distasteful. On a moral level, they are no better or worse than preferring chocolate to vanilla ice cream. Now, if you think, even just for a second, that this position is objectionable, that morality must be something more than tastes and preferences, if you think that things like murder and rape and theft are objectively wrong, then I would say that you are right. You are on to something. And that's if we want to affirm objective morality, if we want to say that some things are truly right and truly wrong, we have to find a foundation for objective morality, and we're not going to find that, it doesn't seem, on evolution. So in this video, I would like to explore what some of these foundations for objective morality could be, and also what some of the problems of moral relativism are. So let's start with some basic definitions. To say something is objective means that it exists independent of any human opinion. So when I am at the zoo and I'm looking at an elephant, which is my favorite animal, by the way, I am having a subjective experience of what most of us would say is an actual object. That elephant actually exists. I'm not just hallucinating that elephant. Now, some people might actually suggest that I am hallucinating that elephant. But I think we have good reason to assume that that elephant is actually there. If we can assume that our faculties are aimed at truth, then we can start as a very basic foundation that there is a world that exists outside of my head, that my sense experience is fundamentally reliable. So even though my experience is subjective, I am experiencing something objective, something that exists independent of my experience. Meaning, if I went out of existence, God forbid, that elephant would still be there, no matter who is experiencing it. That's what it means to say that something is objective. So we see the outside world, we feel the outside world, we hear the outside world, and so we assume, as our starting point, that there is a world outside of our head. We assume, as a starting point, that we actually have a head. And there's no way that we can prove this empirically, since to run any type of scientific test on the outside world, that would require us to already assume that our senses are reliable for that test. Now, why do I bring this up? Well, it's really important because we all have this experience of objective morality. We all have this sense that some things are truly right and other things are truly wrong. So it doesn't seem like we should have a starting point that denies this experience any more than we should have a starting point that denies the experience of the outside world. And somebody like a moral relativist might say, well, you know, we kind of evolved to have a sense of morality. But the same objection could be given to the outside world. Our senses obviously evolved. Our sight obviously evolved. But because our senses evolved, does that mean that there isn't a world outside of our head? So the question isn't whether we evolved to have a sense of the outside world or whether we evolved to have a sense of morality. The question is that evolution discovering something or is that evolution inventing something? So any attempt to explain away morality on evolution is to commit a textbook logical fallacy called the genetic fallacy. And what the genetic fallacy consists of is any attempt to either explain away a position or invalidate a position or explain a position fully by explaining how somebody came to hold or believe in that position. So let me give you a pretty easy example. Say you run into somebody and that person says, hey, did you know that 2 + 2 = 4? And then you say to that person, look, the only reason you think that 2 + 2 = 4 is because your brother told you that, and everybody knows that your brother is an idiot when it comes to math. Now, all that may be true. That person may very well believe that 2 plus 2 equals 4 because their brother said so, and their brother may very well be an idiot when it comes to math. But that all has absolutely nothing to do with the truth of the claim 2 plus 2 equaling 4. The claim is something that we have to evaluate independently of how we came to know about it. Well, same thing with morality. It may be true that we come to hold certain moral beliefs through the socio-biological evolutionary process, but that does nothing at all to say whether or not those beliefs actually exist or are mere illusions. Again, we have to evaluate the claim independently of how we came to know about it. So at this point, the moral relativist might say something like, how do you know that our faculties are aimed at truth? How do you know that there's any tracking between the evolutionary process and truth at all? Who's to say that we can trust our moral experience or our sense experience of the external world? Now, this objection is funny for a couple of reasons. One is, if we deny that our faculties are aimed at truth, then we have no justification or warrant for believing anything, including the claim that our faculties are not aimed at truth, or that evolution is true, or that the world exists outside of our head, which would just be to commit intellectual suicide. There'd be no meaning in having any type of conversation about anything ever again if we assume that everything is merely an illusion, which again, we wouldn't have any belief for even assuming that. So that objection fails miserably. But if we accept the opposite, which it seems like we're forced to, then we have no reason to, again, deny starting from the properly basic belief of a truly right and truly wrong aspect of reality any more than we have reason to deny that the world outside of our head exists. So there's probably one more common objection that the moral relativist might make to the existence of objective moral values and duties. And that, of course, is looking at the differences in moral behaviors and beliefs across time, across cultures, and even across individuals. And they might say something like, hey, if objective moral values and duties exist, how do you explain cannibalism? How do you explain people that eat other people, or the Holocaust, or slavery, all these moral abominations? How can some things be truly right and truly wrong, and people have such differences in how they behave and what they think is right and wrong? Now, this is actually a pretty easy objection to address. One is that just because objective moral values and duties exist, nobody is saying that our moral sense is infallible. And this is one reason why we can't assume that humans would be any type of standard of objective morality, because they often disagree about what is right and what is wrong. But what is common to all of them is that there is a sense that some things are truly right and some things are truly wrong. And when we look at different cultures, times, people, places, we see that this sense is there, but there might be a difference in interpretation of moral facts. So for example, even the cannibal does subscribe to the sense that it is right to care for your neighbor. The only problem, and this is a problem, is they don't see other tribes as their neighbor. They see them as dinner. Same thing with the practice of slavery. You'll notice that even the founding of America, we have certain sayings that all men are created equal, but how then could we have ever practiced slavery? Well, there was a very significant and reprehensible interpretation of fact, and that was the suggestion that people who are slaves are somehow not exactly people or less than people. So we get interpretations and moral facts wrong all the time. But the problem the relativist faces with this is, if relativism is true, then there's nothing wrong with cannibalism. There's nothing wrong with slavery. This is just a person's preference. This is just what they happen to value, and you can't praise it or you can't condemn it. But if objective moral values and duties do exist, then we have some type of standard to measure progress by. It's very important to understand that the whole idea of moral progress only makes sense if there is some type of transcendent anchor point from which we can measure progress by. Otherwise, we don't really have moral progress. We just have moral change. So if you think things like the Holocaust and slavery are truly wrong, truly evil, then you are once again affirming the existence of moral values and duties, even if humans often do get the facts wrong. So we are getting to the final question. If objective moral values and duties exist, where do they come from? Where are they found? Because if God does not exist, if we hold to atheism or naturalism, then objective moral values and duties cannot exist. They would have no ontological foundation. We would be reduced to moral relativism. But we've just seen that moral relativism can't be right. So if premise one is, if God does not exist, objective moral values and duties do not exist, and then premise two is objective moral values and duties do exist, it would follow logically and necessarily that God exists. At this point, somebody might object, is something good because God wills it, or does God will something because it's good? And neither of these answers seems quite right. Because in the first instance, it would make it appear as if morality is arbitrary, that God could have willed anything to be good. But at the same time, it also seems like some things are necessarily evil. We can't really imagine a world where torturing a small innocent child for fun could be a good thing, no matter who willed it. So that doesn't seem acceptable. The other alternative, does God will something because it's good, would make it seem like there's something higher than God. But if God is anything, he is the greatest conceivable being. So that doesn't seem quite right either. But the answer to this objection is actually pretty simple. A euthyphro dilemma is not a true dilemma. In logic, a dilemma has a form of either A or not A. For example, either God exists or he does not exist. There is no third alternative. But the euthyphro dilemma has the form of A or B. And the answer is actually C. God himself is the objective standard of goodness. Moral values are found in God's essentially good nature, and moral duties come from God's will, which are a reflection of his nature. At this point, if we want to affirm our deep and basic sense that some things in this world are truly right and other things in this world are truly wrong, then we also have every reason to affirm that these moral values and duties are sent to us and bestowed upon us by some absolute moral authority, and that we have no reason to think that something like moral relativism is true. Not only does it lead to a number of irreconcilable absurdities, but it rebels against our most properly basic moral experience. But in order to have our truly right and truly wrong, we must also affirm the existence of a moral law giver. So the question of can you be good without God isn't can you be a good person without believing in God. Don't make that mistake. There are many good moral people who do not believe in God. That isn't the question. And there are also many, and have been many, absolutely reprehensible people who believe in God. The question is much deeper than that. The question is really, can there even be goodness without God? Or can there even be wrongness or evil without God? And as we have seen, there simply cannot be. So on the most fundamental level, no. You cannot be good without God. So we should thank God for allowing us to be good.